Hello, my name is Simon Marsh and welcome to another 108 Harley Street CPD snippet. 108 Harley Street is a fully independent, multidisciplinary medical chambers with consultants in a variety of specialties that you can see illustrated at the bottom of the slide. Now, I work not only in the London Breast Clinic, but also in the London Skin Clinic, and I lead the Gilmore Groin and Hernia Clinic. This talk is sort of part of our series on topics related to 108 Harley Street and the services we provide, and they're presented as a live lunchtime event, as well as being recorded and placed on our website for leisurely later consumption. Now, normally we'll do a talk on one topic with around 12 slides, about 20 minutes, to keep things easily digestible and not too onerous. As ever, if you have any thoughts of things you'd like me or my colleagues to cover, please send us an email on the address you can see on the slide, symposia@108harleystreet.co.uk. Similarly, we would normally have one or two key slides with the important learning points on them. But not today, because today is a special edition 108 Harley Street CPD snippet. It was early in the morning on Wednesday, the 13th November, 2019, just a year ago, that I learned the news that Jerry Gilmore, the founder of 108 Harley Street, had died. I want to dedicate this short talk to him, and in particular, what made him the unique character and force that he was, and how he inspired and founded and continues to inspire 108 Harley Street. So, welcome to this 108 Harley Street CPD snippet on remembering Jerry Gilmore, the Redoubtable Disectarian. Now, it's quite hard to sum up Jerry in just a couple of words. There was just so much to him. So I did, I'm afraid, need a thesaurus to help me. I think most people will have a sense of what a redoubtable character is, but it's still nevertheless interesting just to add some formal definitions. Any of you who know Jerry will recognize his redoubtability from those synonyms on the left. And those of you who are unfortunate enough not to have crossed paths with him will begin to get the essence of the man. Illustrious, formidable, brave, courageous, and so on. I must admit, a disectarian took a bit more research on my part, but again, I think you'll see how well it applies. An innovator, a non-conformist, an agitator, and a revolutionary and a free thinker. And to those characteristics, I would add an original thinker, someone who was unconventional and just occasionally a little bit irreverent. Now, I think it's fair to say that Jerry followed an unconventional role into medical training. And he commented that nowadays, there's no way he would be allowed to study medicine. Considering his subsequent achievements and prominence, I'd suggest that this reflects more on the inadequacy and ineffectualness of the modern selection process rather than on Jerry himself. He largely failed his A-levels and resat them at the local technical college, where for the first time he put academic attainment above sporting achievement and actually passed all three subjects in a single term. His father, who was a GP, always refused to tell him where he'd actually studied. And so Jerry applied to 10 of the then 12 London teaching hospitals. He always said that he had no acceptable hobbies at the time, and so he invented three for each application. Unfortunately, he forgot which ones he'd used on which form. And at his interview for Bart, the dean, Alison Nash, who was interviewing him, and a pillar of the Christian Union, commented on his alleged hobby of architecture and asked which specific aspect interested him in particular. After a very short pause, Jerry announced with enthusiasm, "Ecclesiastical, sir," only for the reason that during his childhood, his father had dragged him around many of the cathedrals of Europe. Jerry was offered his place there and then. Towards the end of his training, he found himself back at Barts and a member of the Junior Doctors Executive Committee at the time of the Cartland reforms in the NHS. The junior doctors voted for strike action, and it fell to Jerry not only to inform the Health Secretary, Barbara Cartland, but also the Barts Consultants Medical Council. He was warned that he would never work in London again. But in the sort of turnaround that epitomised his career, he found himself a consultant at Barts in under a year. And in passing, and just to give you an insight into his intellect, he was awarded the Begley Prize by the Royal College of Surgeons of England for obtaining top marks in his finals, the Moynihan Prize by the Association of Surgeons of Great Britain, and the Hamilton Bailey Prize by the International College of Surgeons. In 1976, he was awarded the Master of Surgery degree by the University of London, and he was then appointed as a Hunterian Professor by the Royal College of Surgeons of England. Oh, and there was just a small matter of the Fellowship of the Institute of Sports Medicine. The rest, I suppose, as they say, is history. Now, there are three broad things that I want to focus on as I walk you through my own recollections of Jerry. The first two relate to his capacity for originality and the ability to think laterally and see opportunities. The last is a bit more personal and just reflects his legendary generosity. So I'd like to start with what he is perhaps best known for by the population at large, not surprisingly, Gilmore's groin. In 1980, already established as a surgeon of some note, he was referred three what were then first division footballers, two of them were also internationals. All had been unable to play football for periods of up to 6 months because of undiagnosed and intractable groin pain. Each had had many opinions, had a catalogue of x-rays and scans, including bone scans and CT scans, because of course MRI scans didn't exist then. And they all came to see Jerry, and he did what we were all taught to do. He took a history, he listened carefully to what the patients told him. He realised there was a pattern to the symptoms of all three. He examined them using his knowledge of anatomy, physiology and function, and correctly induced there was a musculotendinous problem in the joint, in the groin. He operated on all three and found the same pattern of torn muscles and tendons. By anatomically repairing the tissues, they were all able to return to elite level sport and international duty within 6 weeks. And I think this illustrates the difference between Jerry and so many others. He was able to discern what others could not. By thinking laterally, one of his maxims, and with his eye for detail, and by relying on his fundamental knowledge and actually listening to and examining the patient properly, he realised not only what the problem was, but how to fix it. He personally operated on nearly 5,000 sportsmen and over 500 internationals. And the clinic itself has now performed nearly 8,000 operations, and many sporting careers have been salvaged. Just to illustrate how Jerry was able to see what others miss, I want to show you this slide. It's an amalgamation of two of his original slides that he used to show when he lectured, explaining the cause of Gilmore's groin. And it shows how applying a fundamental understanding of anatomy and physiology is, and always has been, essential in medicine. Too often now, people seem to treat scans and x-rays and not patients. By knowing the mechanism of action of the relevant muscles, along with their origins, insertion and functions, the cause is explained. The quads become too strong and pull the pelvis down. The tilted pelvis stretches the abdominal muscles, which weaken and can no longer stabilize the pelvis. Overuse leads to recurrent tears and eventually to full-blown groin disruption or Gilmore's groin. And this is still widely recognised as the definitive sequence of events causing Gilmore's groin and guides the technique of anatomical repair, which we formally call a groin reconstruction, that he pioneered so successfully. Now, even though it was the groin that made him famous, his greatest contribution, in my opinion, was the establishment of 108 Harley Street and the principles it embodies. Having set up the NHS breast unit at Barts, he realised the need for something similar but better in the private sector. He also appreciated that what was required was an all-encompassing diagnostic centre and set about acquiring the right premises and equipping it not only with consulting rooms but also with mammography, x-ray facilities, ultrasound scan and a minor surgery suite. I still vividly recall my first meeting with him, and I will admit that I was more than a little overawed, and it was his passion for team working that really came across. And it's the team that remains the secret of the success at 108 Harley Street. Jerry realised that multidisciplinary team working always led to the best outcomes for the patient. And that was apt, really, because his overriding and most basic axiom was always put the patient first. He was able to gather experts in surgery, oncology, pathology and radiology. There was always an atmosphere of mutual respect and trust. Discussion and debate were encouraged and different opinions were valued. Because everyone was secure in their own abilities, there was no conflict and there were no personal agendas to pander to. Everybody got on with each other and everybody got on with putting the patient first. We even did that thing that now seems to be banned in the NHS. We had fun. He established regular educational symposia and GP meetings, as well as instigating an annual reception for all local doctors to attend so that everyone could get to know each other, enhancing and augmenting the communication between professionals that's fundamental to excellent patient care. And what he pioneered, other private institutions rushed to imitate. From the GP meetings to the annual reception, the other units started doing the same. Indeed, it even became the norm for other private breast units to watch and see which new mammogram machine 108 installed before copying us and buying exactly the same one. What 108 did, everyone else followed. He also started the first weekly multidisciplinary team meetings in the private sector, in addition to the quarterly grand rounds he'd been running for many years. And he made sure that data collection was robust and complete. And it was that concentration of specialist knowledge, the information and support that 108 could offer, along with good communication and the continuity of care, something that's to all intents and purposes non-existent in the NHS now as it chases non-clinically relevant managerial targets, that's led to the high level of service we continue to provide. And this effective multidisciplinary team working has led to the best outcomes for all 108 patients. The other thing I'd like to mention regarding his contribution to breast surgery that again illustrates his innovation, and it's something for which he probably doesn't receive the recognition he deserves. It's a surgical technique that he championed that reduced the need for reoperation in those patients undergoing breast-conserving surgery with breast cancer. So those ladies having a wide local excision, often still called a lumpectomy. Because of the accurate data he collected, Jerry noticed that in these patients, some 20% needed further surgery after removal of their breast cancer to make sure the margins were clear. Clear margins are still one of the best indicators for reducing the risk of local recurrence, and it's fundamentally important to achieve clear margins at surgery. Even though, when you do an operation, surgeons, we always check carefully to make sure there seems to be a rim of normal tissue around the cancer, and we'll even x-ray the specimen for extra security. What we found was that once the full pathology was available, in 1 in 5 cases, it turned out that microscopically, the margins were too close, and a further procedure was required to remove more tissue to make sure the margins were clear to reduce the risk of local recurrence. Jerry realized that if you took these 4 quadrant cavity shavings at the original operation, the reoperation rate fell to around 5%. In other words, by adopting this straightforward surgical technique, the number of breast cancer patients needing a second operation fell from 1 in 5 to 1 in 20. And it also reduced the number of ladies who ended up having a mastectomy. Now, for reasons that I never really got to understand, this seemed to cause some controversy at the time, despite the fact the advantages to the patient seemed clear. We presented our results at the Association of Surgeons meeting in Bournemouth in 2010, and since then, many studies from all around the world have shown very similar figures confirming the benefit. Despite this, it's sad that the average reoperation rate in the UK remains 20%, because people still seem reluctant to do this. However, I am pleased to say this technique has now been officially recognised by the NHS as the standard technique for reducing reoperation rates. Now, because I took this technique to my NHS practice and did an audit and persuaded my colleagues there to do the same, our reoperation rates were what's termed a positive outlier. In other words, they were just so much better than anywhere else because they ran at this 5% level. This was picked up by the NHS National Breast Unit Review System under the Getting It Right First Time audit, known as GERFT. And this technique will be used to exemplify breast practice nationally. I'm very pleased that I was able to tell Jerry about this vindication of his technique. Now, I can't really ignore Jerry's legendary generosity. He loved rugby, having played at school, a medical school. He used to organise the Barts Rugby Club dinners and always book them in the name of the St Thomas's Hospital Choral Society, so as not to raise any suspicion. He had his debates at Twickenham and his hospitality was fabled. Many of his friends and colleagues were invited not only to watch the game, but also to partake of the post-match picnic served in the back of his Range Rover. I was lucky enough to go on several occasions. And as an illustration of how his generosity worked, I'd just like to share this more personal story with you, if I may. My wife's a GP, and her GP trainer, Richard Pierce, and his family became really good friends of ours over 20 years. Richard retired at the age of just over 60 and very sadly died shortly after from a very aggressive brain tumour, a glioblastoma multiforme. But we kept in touch with his wife and his family. We knew them all well. And I can't really remember exactly how it came about. His wife, Trinda, also a long-term family friend, must have mentioned in passing, not long after Richard's death, that she'd always wanted to go to Twickenham to see the rugby. And again, I can't recall the details, but obviously somehow this came up in a conversation with Jerry in a roundabout way. And before I knew it, he'd arranged tickets for us to join her and everybody else for a match, not only for lunch beforehand, but for an eventful picnic afterwards. No second thought, he just did it. He was like cricket. He was an MCC member, went to Lords a lot wherever he could. His generosity with tickets and buffets extended here too. And one Friday afternoon, he phoned me up and said I should join him for the one-day international between England and Australia on a Saturday, which I did. I'm sure I enjoyed the game, but I must have enjoyed the refreshments more. Lords was also the place where he held many dinners to thank all the 108 team for their efforts in keeping the country's most successful, fully independent practice going. And then there was Odin's, now sadly closed. Odin's was one of Jerry's favourite restaurants, a proper, old-fashioned, traditional place where people would go to do business. All the tables different sizes and properly spaced, so no one could overhear anybody else's conversation. I lost count of the number of celebrities, captains of industry, sporting greats I saw over the years, many of whom I suspect had been his patients for one thing or another. He knew all the staff and they all knew him. He was always warmly greeted. It was customary for Jerry to have a bottle of champagne on special nights out, and on one occasion as we sat down, the waiter presented a bottle to Jerry for his approval, before he even asked for it. "Aha," said Jerry in his usual brilliant way. "Is that one on the house?" The waiter hardly drew breath before replying, "No, sir, the only thing on the house is the roof, but we drank it anyway." And it wasn't just fine dining. Often the Thursday evening, he would simply give me a ring and say, "Let's go out for a drink." And whilst the 1888 in Devonshire Street, previously the Devonshire Arms, was a common meeting place, he introduced me to many of the other pubs around the area where we would sit and put the world to right, think laterally, and plan the ongoing success of 108. He gave me opportunities I never imagined I would have. I suppose I ought to say something on the lines of he knew how to spot potential and nurture it, and of course I would say that, but I think you'd probably find that others would agree. And this is something I'm very keen we continue to do at 108. He was an unparalleled mentor, always encouraging, always guiding. He was generally interested in people. And his memory was simply phenomenal. After he retired from clinical practice, I'd regularly have patients ask me to remember them to him. And on one of our Thursday evenings, I would mention that Mrs. Smith had asked after him. He would immediately tell me, not only when he first saw her and for what, but all about her family. He would know the names of her husband and her children, what the husband did, where the children went to school, where they live, and where they like to go on holiday. A formidable talent. And another thing that just added to his magnetism. On that Thursday, before the Monday, when I diagnosed his bowel cancer, went to Barts, where he'd been asked to give a talk on Gilmore's groin, and I will never forget this one. The way he could keep an audience fascinated and spellbound, and the respect he engendered from everyone there. And of course, it was followed by a sumptuous meal. Of all the attributes he valued from his friends and colleagues, my impression is that it was loyalty that he considered the most important. And following his lead, 108 will always be loyal to those who are loyal to 108. And in all the time I knew him, he never lost his sense of fun, his self-deprecating sense of humour. The picture on the left is the day after he had his hip replacement. And throughout all his health problems, he remained an extraordinarily good patient. I remember visiting him a few days after his partial hepatectomy to remove some of the metastases from his appendiceal cancer. I was looking at his charts and he asked me how things were looking. I told him it was looking particularly good and that his liver function tests were normal, to which he responded with his usual gusto, belying the fact that he'd undergone major abdominal surgery just a few days before. He said, "Ha ha, first time in 40 years. And even as his physical health began to deteriorate, he remained mentally sharp and his attention to detail never waned. His love and his passion for life in all its rich tapestry was palpable and infectious. It's the contrast, he used to tell me, that's one of the most important factors in enjoying life to the full. And he certainly did that. So much has changed in my career of more than 30 years in NHS and 20 years at 108 Harley Street, working with one of the great surgeons, visionaries and innovators of our time. And it does at times feel as if our proud profession, which with its rich history of medical innovation, led by those extraordinary characters, is suffering what you might term a creeping unionisation. Healthcare, like so much else, has fallen prey to the politically driven culture of tick box mentality, of managed care. You're supposed to do it by the book or not at all. Managerial and regulatory knee-jerk responses to apparent problems produce inappropriate and often unworkable solutions with no real improvement in the quality of patient care. Original thinkers are muffled and true characters are now despised and expunged. The inertia of today's healthcare system is such that, like an intellectual black hole, innovation and brilliance are sucked in, never to be seen again. Like a homeopathic remedy, the influence of consultants has been diluted to such an extent that although we're told we have a positive effect, deep down it's hard to believe that we make any difference at all, as everything is reduced to the lowest common denominator. And it's this we must all continue to fight against, to confront the ordinary, the undistinguished, and the uninspired, to strive for excellence, integrity, and quality, and to always challenge the system, to uphold the principles he stood for, and for which 108 Harley Street continues to epitomise as a legacy of our founder and inspiration. Jerry Gilmore. We will always put the patient first, as he did, and I would urge you all to be redoubtable disectarians.